Isaac is right here, and Bob Nicola, who are filing a civil lawsuit. We actually filed it this morning in federal court right here against the city of Sacramento, the city manager, and the director of Parks and Recreation. And what we're asking is that the court look at the parks closure rule, which is the basis on which the Occupy Sacramento, a movement that's sweeping the country in association with Occupy Wall Street, has been foreclosed from staying overnight. We've asked the court to take a look at that, realize that it's unconstitutional, and strike it down so that the Occupy movement can continue to grow, not just during the day, but at night when a lot of people who are otherwise unable to come out, and join the movement. So that's what we've asked the court, and we are following in the footsteps of Occupy Nashville, Occupy Cleveland, Occupy Cincinnati. They filed similar lawsuits because the city fathers in those places have decided that the best thing to do to deal with the disgruntled populace, the citizenry who are complaining about the whole degradation of our way of life, that they can be best dealt with by just being moved off of the public square. So this lawsuit is designed to say, hold on a second, we have a public square here. It's the Cesar Chavez Park, and that's the place where we assemble, that's where we talk, that's where we learn, that's where we grow, that's where we get stronger, that's where we demand of our government that they represent us. So we're hopeful that having gotten this case, we'll now send a paper to the street and then give us a hearing so we can get a preliminary injunction the enforcement of this unconstitutional statute. Now you may ask, why is it unconstitutional? And if you look at the park closure rule, what it says is nobody can remain in or loiter in the park after 11 o'clock during weekdays or 12 o'clock at night on Friday night, Saturday night. However, if the director of the Park and Recreation wants to sponsor an event or even co-sponsor an event, well then he can do it. It's all up to him. Now that is unbridled discretion, untrammeled discretion, and that leads to an abuse. And the abuse is that there is favored and disfavored speech. And unless there is a clear standard that's set out that the public officials have to follow, then how do we know that they're not going to just suppress some speech, like Occupy Sacramento and this movement, which is growing across the country, and favor other speech? So that's the principal basis on which this regulation is attacked. And of course, you know that the district attorney, who is responsible for prosecuting cases in this county, has already weighed in on this and said clearly that in her view, there are no violations of state law. That means that the city attorney is left to pick up the pieces and to push forward this illegal, unconstitutional restriction on First Amendment, freedom of assembly, freedom of speech, against the people who come here to really talk and learn and exercise those First Amendment rights. So we have the city administration, assuming that the city council, the city attorney, speaks for the city administration. We have her unilaterally deciding that she's going to prosecute. So she is now bringing her people into court to prosecute the 79 so far Occupy Sacramentans who have been arrested. And we have, together with many lawyers in the city, joined to provide a defense for those unfortunates who actually are going to jail to show how important the exercise of First Amendment rights are to them. So that behind me there are some attorneys also, if I can point them out. Well, Josh Kaizuka is somewhere in this range of people, and he has, I think we now have over 20 volunteer lawyers who have stepped forward together with public defenders, asking that these folks get trials. We are confident that once there are trials, no jury, assuming that the city attorney actually follows through and tries these cases, no jury will convict First Amendment loving people who want to follow the Constitution for violating this narrowly drawn or improper improperly and illegally drawn park closure rule. So that's basically it. And now, if anybody from Occupy Sacramento has anything to add, John, do you want to address the group, Carter?
Yeah, I'd like to say something.
Okay, step forward.
Could we have your name first, please?
My name is Kevin Carter, and I'm one of the organizers. And the most important thing right now, not just for the city of Sacramento, but all over the state where this is happening, our First Amendment right, the cornerstone to our democracy, is at risk right now. Because if they make their decision to turn this towards the city, then what do we have left as a people? Now, when the mayor said there's an ample time to do this, was there an ample time when people lost their homes? Is there an ample time when we struggle right now to look for job creation? Is there ample time now for the homeless? You know, and those are in safe ground, you know, and their permit is up. So what does ample time mean? You know, and right now, there was no ample time when all this was done. This was overnight, a 24-hour process, that all these things that occurred that are happening. That's why it's so important right now that we're able to have that park and set up so that we can be in communications with everybody else around this country so that we can come up with solutions, because that's what we're out there for, to come up with solutions inside of our grievances, to bring back and present to the city hall, to the governor, and to the rest of the state. That's what the purpose is about being out there in that park. Cesar Chavez Park is the right place to be, and we want to prove that tonight.
We have with us many persons who were actually arrested, and I'm sure that after you ask questions, you can buttonhole any individual and find out why they felt compelled to get out there and express their First Amendment rights.
Can you address how much of this movement on your behalf
statute that's not being enforced against the homeless person? They're two entirely different things. As you know, lawyers do lots of different kinds of cases, and this is a totally separate case from the class action Lair versus Count, the city of Sacramento, that went to a jury trial that resulted in a victory. But this is a separate case and a separate ordinance. This is a park closure ordinance, and that's what we're looking at, and I don't join the two. I think that the city, however, has problems, both in dealing with homeless people, dealing with, you see there's a group of people who are protesting the conditions in juvenile hall. They have problems dealing with juvenile hall. Well, here's Bob Bucola. Now, come forward, Bob. Mr. Bucola is a fantastic attorney, and he can tell you why he's out joining this defense, I'm sure, on his own.
Absolutely. Well, there's been a very arbitrary city ordinance that's been drafted, and it's not appropriate for the police and the city manager to dictate what causes or not. And certainly that doesn't trump the Constitution of the United States. We have a right to peaceably assemble. This is quite a message. The way curfew has been delineated here, many people's voices aren't being heard. Those that are working two shifts to support their family that want to be heard about this very important cause. It's absolutely unconstitutional. It's a violation of our rights as citizens.
Can you guys talk about or name groups that have been allowed to stay past curfew to sort of show how you're being discriminated?
Well, actually, I was just in the office of the Downtown Partnership Association, and the director looked out over the park and said, well, yes, we regularly see events that go on beyond curfew, and the parks director or the city wants to sponsor them, they go on. So he's aware that it's regularly and frequently permitted, except it's not permitted for a group such as Occupy Sacramento, which is taking on the issues that underlie the problems in this country.
Do you have any specific examples of events that
happened after curfew? You'll have to ask Michael Walsh, who's the Downtown Partnership. Yeah, I'm sure he keeps track of them. He'll give them all to you.
Well, you're the one suing the city, not Michael. So how are you going to make your case if you don't have any examples of how you're being discriminated against?
We make our case based on the fact that the ordinance itself gives untraveled discretion to the director of Parks and Rec to allow whoever